was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light that shines in darkness. The darkness has not overcome it. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world. Though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. That is what we celebrate at Christmas time, and that is what we celebrate at this time. Because you see, he lived to be a strong man who lived a life of perfection. And the night before he was betrayed, he took bread. Simple bread and broke it and said, take and eat, each one of you. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. The same way after supper, he took the cup and said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for the sins of. As often as you eat the bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Oh, thank you, Father God, for that proclamation. For the time that we have just now to remember the birth, the coming, the pre-existence of the death, the burial, resurrection, the power of all of that, offering grace to all of us, forgiveness of our sins. Let us celebrate that forgiveness all the days of our lives. Let us fight against sin as he did. Let us bond together as a body, as Christ's body, here in Santa Clara. Let us become the territory, your territory, not Satan's territory. And Father, we think of those among us who are struggling, Jim and Mary, Aldine and Joe and Lydia, and we think of those who are struggling financially. Pat, we're praying that you would give them a job soon. Marcella, give her a job that will help her to pay the rent and help her family, help her mom and dad, and be able to move in with her, find a better, bigger, better place. So many needs, Father, that we all have as a body. We thank you for the time we have to remember those needs. Those who are not complicated, Father God. Bless them. Thank you so much that they're in the places where you sent them and that they will be light there. Thank you for each one. So now it's time for, yes, now it's time for the offering. As we celebrate Christ's sacrifice, let us also sacrifice to him the things that we need to do for the trays.
That's where you are.
Boy, a preacher forgetting the offering, that's a bad thing. Let's stand up and sing this.
Thank you.
My precious family,
be a commentator on the radio back in the 80s and 90s, I mean, maybe earlier than that, but I wasn't listening to anything talk at that time. But he had great commentaries every weekday. Every year around Mother's Day, he had a little special little reading for the mothers. And every year at Father's Day, he had a special little reading. And every year at Christmas time, he had a special little reading that tells a story. And this story is about a young family who were married and had the young kids, and the mom and the kids went to church, and the dad did not. He thought church was a crazy thing to do, and he thought it was a waste of time, and that there can't be a God. Why wouldn't God send somebody, send his God come down and live in this world? Since he's a God, why would he bother doing that? So one Christmas Eve, as was the tradition, he stayed home, prepared the fire, and get ready for things that would happen that evening, and sit down and read his paper while the kids and the mom went off to Christmas Eve service. They would spend time Christmas Eve doing their thing, and he would do his thing. This night, he happened to notice it was a particularly cold Christmas Eve, and he happened to notice a thumping every once in a while on the window. Picture window. And he looked out to see what no one was there. He heard a thump again, no one was there. Then he went out and opened the door and noticed that there were some stunned birds lying at the base of the picture window. Because they had flown into the window hoping to get some warmth. Well, he knew he couldn't open that window, so he went up to his shed and he opened the shed and he turned on the light. Hoping that the birds would sense that light and that they would fly into the shed, but they didn't. So then he went out and he turned on the heater inside the shed and he threw seed in there. Maybe they would sense the heat. Maybe they would follow the seed into the shed, but they didn't. He kept trying different things to get those birds to fly in the shed instead of into his window and get stunned and lie there in the cold. And in his frustration, he cried out, just at the time that the church bell rang to let the service go. Oh, if only I could become a bird and tell them where to find their comfort, where to find their warmth. It dawned on him at that time. He became a man who worshiped the Lord, because now he understood why God live among his creatures. So we're going to take a look at in this Advent season, getting through to Christmas. We're going to look at Christmas from the cross, because that is the best way to see Christmas. That the whole reason for Christmas and the pageantry of Christmas is the agony and the defeat of the cross with the victory of the resurrection. So today we're going to take a look at a couple of different passages of Scripture, if you'll join with me. And I know these are not Christmas passages. You don't have to try to talk to me at the door and say, you know, Chuck, that wasn't a Christmas passage. You're right, but we'll get to Christmas in this. Take a look at Luke 23:46 and John 19:30. These are the last couple words of Jesus on the cross. Luke 23:46 says, Jesus called out with a loud voice. Join me, would you please? Jesus called out with a loud voice, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. When he had said this, he breathed his last. And John's account is, when he had received the drink, so what I take it is that he said that, they gave him a drink, he said, I thirst, and they gave him a drink, and this is what John said. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Let's read that with a little more emphasis, okay? When he had received the drink, Jesus said, it is finished. With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. What indeed What did Jesus talk? What was Jesus talking about when he declared that? First of all, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And then he said, it's finished. What was finished? What is the thing that we're looking at? Well, first of all, we know that his name is Jesus, which was given to him by God. When he came into this world, he was given the name Jesus. Notice here in Luke's account of the angel coming to Mary. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent an angel to Gabriel. And the angel Gabriel to a town of Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Mary was greatly troubled with this, the words, and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. It was his assigned name. Gabriel went to Joseph later on and assigned him that same name. So Joseph and Mary were both told to name his their son Jesus. Now you and I don't get someone to assign a name to us. We go through months of trying to decide what we're going to name our child. And we have to pick out two. One for a boy and one for a girl. Maybe not so much now since we have all those reveal parties where we find out who they are, not because of the party, but because of what the doctor knows. And we pick out some kind of name, whether it's for a boy or a girl, and usually it is something that fits in, except we have a couple of families here that are handing down Joe's left and right. You know? Joe, everyone is Joe. Joe Lee, Joe, no, I'm there. So we've got families handing down Joe because there's specific meaning to it. I have a name of my two grandfathers, Charles Fairbrother and Norton Bear. So my name is Charles Norton Fairbrother. And therefore, that had meaning to my mom and dad. I usually spent a lot of time hiding my middle name because who has a Norton for a middle name? Sounds like a story from Dr. Seuss or something. Anyway, we all have different ways of thinking. Usually we just end up on a name that is attractive. Now, there are other places that say, you know, we're naming them after the day they were born, or we're naming them after the event that happened around the time of their birth. God always gave names that had meaning. In fact, sometimes he changed names. Remember, Abram became Abraham, and one was an exalted father, the other was the father of many, right? And Jacob became Israel, from person who grabbed at the heel of his brother, that's what he was named after. He grabbed, he's a grabber, he's trying to usurp authority to child of God. And Paul became Saul, we all know that. Peter was named, Simon was named Peter. So always given some names that have more meaning to them for him. And so he gave this name, Jesus, an assigned name, and they both knew it. They both came to it that way. They both understood it. Jesus, what does Jesus mean? Why is it so important? Well, Jesus means Jehovah saves, actually. And so Jehovah or Yeshua saved, and it is the Greek term for the Hebrew term Joshua. Joshua and Jesus are the same name in different languages. So that means God had a special meaning for him, and that was that he would be the one who saved, that God would save humanity through him. Jesus would be the Savior of the world. That was the important thing to God. Call him Jesus. Though he had all kinds of other titles like Emmanuel, Eternal Father, and things like that, he was the Son of God, Son of Man. He was Jesus. Joshua. So it makes us think of Joshua, the promised land, a little bit. That's when we look back at Joshua what he did. He led his people into the promised land. This was a picture of the salvation. Coming out of the desert of sin, coming out of slavery to sin, through the desert of sin, into the promised land. And Joshua was there the whole time as they walked through and conquered the promised land. Jesus comes with us, leading us into salvation, the promised land. Jesus is the one who guides us through and helps us fight all our battles, all the things that we struggle with, all those lusts we have, all those cravings we have. He helps us battle everyone that wants to take us over so that he can eventually bring us into heaven with him. That's the plan. That was what his job was. That was what his name meant. So let's talk about his mission then. His mission is Jesus, the Savior, Jehovah saves. That was all that he did. Let's read Matthew's account of the same thing. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her privately. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Okay, so what is the mission of Jesus? Well, first of all, he was dedicated to that mission. We know that. From the very beginning, even as a child, he was dedicated. He brought people, the angels brought people in to celebrate his birth, because he was dedicated to the salvation of the world. That was that through him would be peace on whom God's favor rests. But the time came for the purification rites. So now at 8 days old, this is only 8 days after he was born, when the time came for purification rites required by the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. So he was being dedicated at the very point that that's what you did with your firstborn son. The firstborn son was for sure someone that you came and dedicated to the Lord. Because every firstborn child of the Israelite nation was God's. Remember that happened on the Passover? When the Passover happened, the angel, death angel came along. He was coming to take all the firstborn children of all the nations except for those who were covered in the blood of the Lamb. That's what we just celebrated, the Lord's Supper. Passover time, when Jesus established that. So there it is. Jesus is dedicated at that time, given, and we know about the stories about Annas and Simeon, all of them coming in and saying, "Wow, what a great child. Now the salvation of the world will come." Both of them are saying, "Wonderful things are happening, but the salvation of the world is coming." So that was, he was dedicated to that purpose. And at 12 years old, while he was once again visiting Jerusalem, he stayed up behind. Remember the story? And Mary and Joseph took off, went home, and they realized at some point that he wasn't there. So they went back to Jerusalem to find him. And they looked all over for him, where they find him in the temple. And he says to them, "Why were you searching for me?" He asked. "Didn't you know that I had to be in my Father's house?" Other versions say, "I had to be says that in John 17, John 3:16-17. Open up your heart. Let me come in. Whosoever wills, whoever wants to, can be accepted. So he came to seek and save the lost. How did that happen? How did he seek and save the lost? He did that by what his mission was, finding lost people, meeting the needs and caring for them. He had a wonderful, marvelous way of being established both as God in working all those wonderful miracles, healing the sick, healing the lame, healing the deaf, and giving sight to the blind. All those things he did, saying, see, I'm God. I'm in control of all of nature. I'm in control of the aches and pains of your body. I'm in control of the wind and the waves. I can walk on water, and none of you can. Why? Because I am God. And his whole time was spent looking for the lost. Those hurting people who would respond to the message of love and calling for a place of rest, they could find it in Jesus. So his advent, what does advent mean? Advent means a thing that happens. Person who comes. That's their advent. Okay, so we're celebrating advent right now. This is the second week of advent. And what is his advent? The word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father full of grace and truth. His advent was that God came in him. He was not a chosen man out of all the men, like Moses was chosen out of all the men of Israel, all the children of Israel. Joshua was chosen to follow Moses. David was a chosen man and assigned to be the king of the nation. There are lots of chosen men that God chose to work with them. Most of them balked at the idea, but Jesus came voluntarily to be the very one who would do God's will and open up the door to heaven for all of us. For God so loved the world, he said that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Jesus, Savior, Joshua, saves. So this isn't a fairy tale. From the very beginning, when God formed the earth and placed it in the middle of a universe that he had just built, he had this plan going. He knew that he was going to have to put a tree in the garden because he didn't want all the people just to be robots and have no other choice but him. He wanted people to respond to him in love. And so he planted that tree in the garden and says, if you love me, you won't touch that tree. Tree of the knowledge of good and evil. You'll leave that alone. But you have to have a choice. You need a treaty. And if you choose the treaty, you will be separated from me. You will surely die, he says. And so there it was. The test, the only single test of each one. We plugged it in a glorious fashion. And we blamed each other. And we do that all the time. Oh, whose fault is it? It's your fault. No, it's your fault. We fight over fighting over it, right? So, this is not a fairy tale that he had set up. Oh, let's pick up somebody. Let's bless them. Let them become the savior of the world. No, he had the plan. And the plan was from his very Son. Probably his idea. Father, we'll know. We'll need that savior. We'll know. We'll need someone to come and break the bonds of sin. That will be happy. We will even one day say, oh, no, they ate the fruit. What are we going to do? Jesus, do you have any idea? Holy Spirit, do you have any idea? No, he didn't do that. He simply knew from that one point that the nature of man would eventually fall away for all of us. And so he planned this event. He planned the birth. And isn't it interesting that the Spirit moved on the surface of the deep, and the Spirit moved on Mary, and both of them brought forth the will and the proposition that Jesus was. just did their light, first light. I think that's on the 17th of this month. So the Wright brothers decided to try to make an airplane, so try to fly, and flying worked. And they got one very cold December morning out there on Kitty Hawk off of North Carolina. And so they were there because they chose that spot because it was a good spot. Wind was blowing high there, high cliffs and high dunes that they could fly off of. And they finally, after many, many times of failure, they finally made a flight. They made several little flights that day, four of them, in fact. One of them lasted for all of, I think it was 57 seconds, and it flew 120 feet. So that afternoon, they went and quickly telegraphed their daughter, and their sister, Catherine, and said, "We flew 120 feet. We'll be there. We'll see you at Christmas." It'll take at least that long, 17 to 25, flying 120 feet every day. they said, "By the way, a telepress, show press." And so she ran it down to the press office. And the man read it and said, "Oh, how nice, they're coming home for Christmas." They missed the point. The point was they flew, and that was the beginning of aviation, of the age of aviation. First airplane flew, and from then on we got better and better at it until now we're flying around the world in just a matter of hours. It's amazing. Don't miss the point. All the pageantry and all the angels coming and singing praises and telling people what to do and wise men coming and shepherds coming and all that stuff, don't miss the point. It was the Savior who came. You are in God's kingdom because of the Savior. If you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's because of Christmas Day. The Savior. And he had one purpose. His whole mind was to get to the cross. The cross was the planned destination. Going from manger to cross. The manger actually was glory. The cross was shame. But he took what he would need. He planned that. It is finished. For all of humanity, everyone could accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Everyone could identify with him through the water of grace and baptism. Everyone could know his death, his burial, and his resurrection. The planned destination opened the door to heaven for every one of us. Most gracious, mighty God in heaven, thank you so much for each one. Father, if there's someone here who hasn't lived with that understanding, hasn't accepted that as an understanding, then Father, they need to open up their eyes. And we pray for them that they would. We pray for them that they would enjoy your presence and know your needs. We pray for this in Jesus' name. And Father, if there's anyone else who has any other needs, like would like to be a part of this congregation and we worship together, or we'd like to rededicate themselves so that there's more meaning in their lives when it comes to Christmas time. That we all see Christ and see Christmas through the cross. So we may see it. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Away in me, let's stand up and let's sing. If you have some response you need to make, come forward and do it. We'd love to have you.
No fear for a man.
face-to-face, we can do that, or we can do another computer thing. I didn't pray about that. See, what we want is for everyone to be so excited about the Lord that we are bringing friends in regularly, filling up this building with all our friends and family. So we're hoping that everybody gets involved and does that. We have a great message, don't we?
Amen.
Great message. So let's share it around. By the way, I want you to note some things. Christmas on Saturday the 24th, we are having Christmas Eve service. Now, we're starting it earlier so you can have a longer evening to do whatever it is that you do on Christmas Eve. So, starting at 5 o'clock Christmas Eve. Then on Sunday, we're going to start a little earlier again so that you get a chance to have a longer afternoon to celebrate however you celebrate Christmas Day. So, we're going to start at 10 o'clock then, on Sunday. I hope you can all get up and just work a little harder getting here on time. We'll start right on time and we'll get out. We'll do the same thing on New Year's Day. So we're just changing this a little bit. And if we love it, we'll stay changed. If we like it earlier, I can do that. We can go 7:30 if you want to come at 7:30. Every morning, that's fine. No. Okay.
Just heard some groans.
Okay, so these are things that we're planning on doing this coming open. In fact, turn around and tell somebody the day and time of Christmas Eve right now.
December 24th.
5 o'clock.
5.
What time of Christmas morning is our Sunday service?
10.
What?
10.
10?
Okay, now I know you all heard me. Sometimes I'm not sure of that. Okay, is there anything else I need to tell?
Yes.
Yes.
Because Wednesday night, all the women of the church are invited. Please come at 6:30, a little bit earlier. We're going to have a light dinner and just a wonderful celebration. Please bring a white elephant gift to bring so we can exchange gifts and have some fun, and we'll have a little devotion. It'll be a wonderful evening. So please have everybody's invited. Young, up to, you know, whatever.
Why is it called white elephant?
Because it's something that
you don't want.
Let's be honest. A lot of us just bring like a new little gift we go off by, you know. So whatever you want to do, if you want to go out your garage, it works for me. But just wrap it up. And
you want to bring me a big check? That's fine.
We'll draw names.
Thank you.
But 6:30 on Wednesday.
6:30 Wednesday.